Kujantam Rama Ramiti Madhuram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakham Vande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Kritamastakanjalim Bashpavari Paripurna Lochanam Marutim Namataraksha Santakam Vaidehi Sahitam Suradrumatale Haime Mahamantape Madhye Pushpakamasane Manimaye Veerasane Susthitam Agrevachayati Prabhanjanasute Tattvam Munibhyah Param Vyakhyantam Bharatadibihi Parivritam Ramam Bhaje Shyamalam. The Ramayana series, part 40. Rest well and return soon is the topic of this part. Sri Rama, along with his friend Sugriva and the monkey troops, laid siege on the city of Lanka and started the great war. That war which was never seen by anyone before in the world. The war between the Vanaras and the Rakshasas, the monkeys and the ogres. It was a unique war, and it is said that the Rakshasas or the ogres were actually very powerful warriors. But the combat with the monkeys was very surprising for them, because monkeys would not typically use weapons to fight. They were more comfortable fighting with natural weapons like stones and uprooted trees. So this was something unexpected by the Rakshasa forces. And so they were taken aback and were finding it a little difficult to cope up with this monkey army. This is very beautifully described by Swami Deshikan in the Mahavira Vaibhava, when he says, Akritachara Vanachara Ranakarana Vailaksha Kunitaksha Bahuvidha Raksho Baladyaksha Vaksha Kavata Patana Patima Satopa Kopa Valepa. He says, Akritachara, this war is one which has never happened before. Unique, the first time kind of war. And this is the war between Vanachara, that is the monkeys who dwell in the forests, and the Rakshasas. And in this war, these monkeys went and broke open the iron-like chests of the Rakshasas using natural weapons like trees and stones. Vaksha Kavata Patana Patima, he says. So, thus the Rakshasa forces were all taken by surprise and were not doing so greatly in the war when the war started, it seems. At this time, Indrajit intervened and he tried to bind Rama and Lakshmana with the serpent arrows, but they were freed from that with the help of Garuda, which we saw in the previous part. After this happened, the monkey forces continued to fight with great vigor under the guidance of their commander-in-chief Neela. Neela was a very able warrior monkey, it seems. And Ravana himself was humbled by Neela in one of the combats. Then it so happened that Ravana took on Lakshmana in combat during the war. And this fight between Ravana and Lakshmana ensued for a long time. And at one point, Lakshmana happened to swoon away on the battleground. He fell down. And Ravana thought this was the best chance to take away Lakshmana. And if Lakshmana was taken away, then Rama would be rendered powerless. He would get so emotional that he would just not want to continue the war. So he tried to pick up Lakshmana and take him away from the battlefield. He extended his hands to pick up Lakshmana, it seems. At this time, Hanuman intervened and he punched Ravana with his fist. When he punched Ravana, Ravana actually fell back and almost rolled towards the tree of Lanka, it seems. The feats of Hanuman which have humbled Ravana are so many. Right there in the Ashoka Grove, Hanuman combated and defeated almost all the Rakshasas who were sent by Ravana. And even in the court of Ravana, Hanuman always had an upper hand in his say and his behavior. And when Ravana tried to set fire to the tail of Hanuman, he ended up losing his own city, Lanka, which was set to fire by Hanuman's tail. And now, he had to experience the punch from the fist of the powerful Hanuman. So, he was in bad shape. And once Ravana actually went away because of this punch, Hanuman quickly lifted Lakshmana and took him away from the battlefield. Looking at this state of Lakshmana, Rama decided to now go and fight with Ravana. So he took upon a fight with Ravana. At this time, Hanuman offered to carry Rama on his shoulders so that he could easily meet Ravana, who was seated on his chariot. And thus the first combat between Rama and Ravana ensued. Now it is said that this fight went on very well for quite some time. And after some time, Ravana was a little unhappy fighting Rama. And he thought, let me now try to wound this monkey who is holding Rama. This monkey who came and gave so much of trouble to me at Lanka, created havoc in my beautiful Ashoka garden, and now had the guts to punch me and push me away. Thinking thus, he got so angry that he started releasing arrows on Hanuman. When he did this, it is said that Rama's real anger was aroused. Krodhasya vashameiva. He was just not able to control his anger. He got so angry with Ravana that he started releasing arrows on him in full vigor. Now, one more secret is mentioned here by Srinidhi Swami when he gives an interpretation for the Thiruppavai in this context. It is said that Lakshmana was made to fall by Ravana. This itself made the Lord angry. And then Ravana tried to throw arrows on Hanuman, which angered the Lord even further. But somehow Lakshmana felt that even though Rama would fight Ravana, he would probably not try to kill him at the first instance, just because Rama is so compassionate that he would not try to kill his enemy very easily. He would want to give him a chance. Lakshmana had sensed this. And so he had told Hanuman that if you find my brother falling short in his complete vigor somewhere, just give him a reminder that this Rakshasa, Ravana, was the one responsible for the death of Jatayu. Jatayu, that favorite devotee of the Lord. So that will arouse his anger even more, and then he will be in his full form. So what does all this convey? All this only conveys that the Lord generally does not get angry even on his enemies. But if the enemy tries to do some harm to his devotees, to his near and dear ones, then the Lord actually gets angry. Like in this case, Ravana had done wrong to his dear brother Lakshmana, to his dear devotee Hanuman. And finally, he was even reminded that the very reason why his wonderful father-like, affectionate, respected elder Jatayu was killed was this Ravana. So, listening to all this, Rama's anger was really aroused and he decided to get rid of Ravana. It is said that Pullinvai Kindanai Pollarakkane Killikkalaindan by Andar. Meaning, Pull here refers to Jatayu. Invai Kindan is the one who killed Jatayu. That Arakkan, that Rakshasa, was ruthlessly combated by Rama. Killikkalaindan. What did Rama actually do? Rama went and targeted the crown of Ravana. The crown fell down. Then he targeted the armor of Ravana. That went off. Then he targeted the horses of Ravana's chariot. They went off. The chariot fell down. Then he targeted the charioteer of Ravana and he too was wounded. And there Ravana stood in the battlefield without a chariot, without horses, without the crown and without any weapons. Just one more arrow and that could have been the end of Ravana. But the Lord did not do that. What did he do? He said, Gacchanujanami ranarditastvam pravishya ratrim cha raja lankam ashvasya niryahi rathi cha danvi tadabalam prekshasime rathastaha. He said, permitted by me. You leave this battlefield now. Go to your city Lanka. Rest well this night. And tomorrow come back ready for battle with me. Let us have a battle again tomorrow when you're fresh and rested. Indru poi naalai va, they say. He said, you go today and come back tomorrow. He said this at a point when a single arrow was enough to finish the entire episode. Why did the Lord do this? The only reason was his compassion towards all beings of the universe. Somewhere in the corner of his mind, he thought, if Ravana would realize that there was no chance that he could be spared at the hands of Rama, after having seen the valor of Rama, if he had some kind of fear and some feeling of repentance, and if he could still think of returning back Sita, Rama was ready to forgive him even at that instance. His anger was aroused initially because Ravana had tried to hurt his near and dear ones. So he went to the extent of almost killing Ravana. But again, there, compassion for even his enemy intervened. That is why Andal says, Matrarai Matradika Vallan. Rama does not want to kill his enemies, but he wants to kill enmity that is there in the enemy. The feeling of enmity is what should not be there in one. There is no use of killing an enemy without him having lost his enmity towards you. So Rama thought that if I forgive him today, then maybe he will not think of me as his enemy anymore, and he will try to improve and return Sita. And it is indeed said that at that moment when he was spared by Rama, for that fraction of a second, Ravana really lost his enmity towards Rama. He was in awe and he thought that somebody can even spare another's life at this juncture. So for that moment, he lost that feeling of enmity. For that split second, he lost that feeling of enmity. But being a Rakshasa, the enmity, the feeling of revenge all came back to him. And he was all ready to come back to fight Rama. But the words of Rama telling Ravana to rest well and return soon is an episode which we should always remember forever, thinking about the compassion of Lord Rama. When Swami Deshikan describes this event in his Mahavira Vaibhavam, he uses a beautiful set of words to do this. A set of words which all begin with the letter V. He says, Vinirgata Vishankata Vishika Vitadana Vigatita Makuta Vihkwala Shravastanaya Vishrama Samaya Vishranana Vikyata Vikrama. He says, Vinirgata, the arrow which came out from the bow of Rama, Vishankata Vishika, was as scorching as fire. Vitadana, it came and hit Ravana. Vighatita, and it actually broke Makuta, his crown. Vihvala, and gave him a lot of tiredness. It made him bereft of all his weapons, his armor, his chariot, and his charioteer. And at this time, that son of Vishrava, Vishravastanaya, was granted Vishrama Samaya, the time to rest. And such is the greatness of that great Rama. Vikyata Vikrama, says Swami Deshika. So thus, the compassion of the Lord who told Ravana to rest well and return soon should always be remembered by us. What Ravana did after returning the next day is what we shall see in the next part. Kujantam Rama Rameti Madhuram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakham Vande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra Tatra Krita Mastakanjalim Bashpavari Paripurna Lochanam Marutim Namata Rakshasantakam Vaidehi Sahitam Suradrumatale Aime Mahamantape Madhye Pushpakamasane Manimaye Veerasane Susthitam Agrevachayati Prabhanjanasute Tattvam Munibhyah Param Vyakshantam Bharatadibihi Parivritam Ramam Bhajeshyamalam. The Ramayana series, part 41. Kinsmen Conquered is the topic of today. The
unique war between the monkey army and the ogre army was going on in full swing. The monkeys were dedicatedly serving Lord Rama by fighting in this war. And the Rakshasas, for their part, were serving their master Ravana. And the war that ensued between the two was progressing with full vigor. In this war, initially the monkeys were having an upper hand. To curtail the pace of these monkeys, Indrajit used a trick and he put the Nagapasha Astra on Rama and Lakshmana, which bound them. They got bound by serpents, but this problem did not last long because Garuda came to their rescue, and very soon Rama and Lakshmana came to fight with freshness and greater vigor. Then followed the great combat between Rama and Ravana, and Ravana was almost about to be killed, but Rama compassionately spared him, wanting to give him a chance to think over, repent, come back and return Sita. But Ravana was a Rakshasa, and as a characteristic feature of the Rakshasa clan, repentance was never there in their hearts. So Ravana did feel his enmity having been lost for that split second when Rama forgave him. But after that split second, he got back to even more an angry mode, and his soul itself got filled with revenge, it seems. He wanted to somehow take revenge on that Rama who had spared his life. So he sent many of his powerful Rakshasas and decided that he should send his most powerful brother Kumbhakarna onto the battlefield. We had seen that Kumbhakarna had come and advised Ravana that he had done wrong by abducting Sita, and if he wanted to make amends, he should return Sita back to Rama. But Ravana did not heed to his advice. At that, Kumbhakarna had told him that he would still be with him because he was his brother. So, Ravana thought Kumbhakarna would keep up his words and come and fight for him. So, it seems he sent men to wake up Kumbhakarna. Now, Kumbhakarna was so engrossed in sleep all the time that it was not an easy task to wake him up. If Kumbhakarna had to be woken up, great noises had to be made with various kinds of instruments. Sometimes elephants had to come and trumpet right into his ear. Or sometimes very tasty food had to be cooked and placed near his nose. But this time, when this great war was happening in Lanka, Srinidhi Swami says, none of these, like neither the cries of the elephants nor sounds made by instruments, were needed to wake up Kumbhakarna, because already a great noise was created by the sorrowful cries emanating from the houses of Lanka for having lost their near and dear ones in the war. So that itself was enough to wake up Kumbhakarna, says Srinidhi Swami. Atha nijavarajam kila madhyamam satata suktamabodayadanjasa nahi gajaihi prithubihi nachachamudgaraihi vilapitaihi vividairi samudgataihi. So these sorrowful cries themselves woke up Kumbhakarna, and he realized that Lanka was in danger and Ravana was in need of him. So he went to the palace of Ravana and he did tell him that, brother, this is what I had anticipated. That's why I told you, you must return Sita to Rama. Now see, our city is in such a bad condition. But as I had promised to you, I am here, standing by you at your hour of need. I shall go and fight the Vanara army. Saying so, the mighty Kumbhakarna, who was like a mountain, entered the battlefield, says Swami Deshika. Kumbhakarna kulagiri vidalana damboli bhuta nishanka kanka patra. He came like a kulagiri, like a celebrated mountain, and he started creating havoc in the enemy's side. Kumbhakarna was so huge that as he walked, many monkeys got crushed
under his feet. He would just sway his hand and pick up hundreds of monkeys and crush them within his palms. He was like a walking image of Yama for the monkeys. He was so terrorizing. Some monkeys just swooned away at the very presence and sight of Kumbhakarna. Rama looked at all this and he realized that his side was in danger and that he had to get into action as soon as possible. So Rama decided to fight against Kumbhakarna. Valmiki says this fight was not easy even for Rama. It was not easy even for that Rama whose single arrow had pierced 7 sal trees and whose single arrow had killed the mighty Vali. Even for him, this combat with Kumbhakarna was a tough one. Yasya sayakai salavara nikritta valihato vanara pungavascha te kumbhakarnasya tada sharire vajrapamana vedhayam prachakruhu. Then finally, Rama's arrows pierced the hands of Kumbhakarna and broke them off. Then few of his arrows hit the legs of Kumbhakarna and he was rendered legless. Now without hands and legs, Kumbhakarna became like a ball, it seems. And like a ball, he tried to roll over the enemy's army so that as many monkeys would get crushed under him. This was his commitment towards the cause of his king and brother, that he tried to create havoc even till the last second of his life. That is the way he fought the war. But very soon, this Kumbhakarna was slain with the final arrow by Rama. And that was the end of the mighty brother of Ravana. The fall of Kumbhakarna was a big blow to him. He was just not able to take it. And to add on to this fall of Kumbhakarna, many more heroes from the Rakshasa side were slain. It is said that the great Rakshasa Narakantaka was put to an end by Angada. One named Trishira was slain by Hanuman. One named Mahodara was killed by Neela. And Atikaya was taken care of by Lakshmana. Kumbha was slain by Sugriva. Nikumbha was killed by Hanuman. And Mahodara was killed by Neela. Ravana's morale was going down and down with all this. Then his dear son Indrajit came to his aid and said, "Don't worry, father, I shall do something that will please you." And he entered the battlefield and he directly used the Brahmastra against Rama and Lakshmana. It is said that Rama, Lakshmana and almost the entire army of monkeys fell unconscious under the effect of the Brahmastra. Jambavan, who was old and was watching the war, saw this and realized that this is now time for another duty for Hanuman. Hanuman did not get affected by the Brahmastra because of the boon that he had from Brahma. So he called Hanuman and he told him that, "See, time has come for you to do another service to Rama. There is this wonder herb present in a hill far away from here. That herb is called the Sanjeevani. So you need to get that herb and save Rama, Lakshmana and all the monkeys from this Brahmastra. So hurry up, O Hanuman. Fly as swift as Vayu and go and bring that wonderful herb which can cure all your monkey clan and Rama and Lakshmana." Hanuman did fly to the mountain that he was told to by Jambavan, but he could not actually spot the herb that he was supposed to get. So Hanuman, being Hanuman, decided to carry the entire mountain to that place. That was hardly anything for him. So he decided to carry the entire mountain, which contained hordes of herbs, which were curative. And he came and placed it in front of the Vanara army in no time. It is said that Jambavan picked up 4 important herbs from this mountain. One was Mrita Sanjeevani, which could bring back a dead one to life. One was Vishalya Karani, who could make a lame person walk. Another was Savaranna Karani, which could heal all kinds of wounds. And another one was Santana Karani, which would erase off any marks or scars created by these wounds. So, by using all these wonder herbs, the entire Vanara army was saved, it seems. In fact, Vyakhyatas further go to describe that even the scent of these herbs was enough to cure anybody who was inhaling them. And so the entire army of monkeys got to inhale these herbs. Whether they were alive or dead, the scent of that reached the nose of these monkeys and all of them got saved. But the Rakshasas who were killed in the war did not get saved by this. What was the reason? The reason was Ravana was such an egoist that he did not want dead Rakshasas to be present on the battlefield, because that would only show how much of defeat his army was facing. If he were losing more Rakshasas, it meant that he was getting defeated those many times. So he did not want to show that to anybody. So as soon as any Rakshasa would fall dead on the battlefield, Ravana had made arrangements for him to be thrown into the sea. So because these Rakshasas got thrown into the sea, they were not able to inhale the scent of this wonder medicinal herb Mrita Sanjeevani, and because of that they never got back to life. Whereas all the Vanaras were safely kept, the bodies of the Vanaras who had given up their lives were safely safeguarded by Sugriva, because he felt that they deserved an honorable disposal. So he had kept them safe. But then, now there was no need for disposing them off, because they all came back to life and they came back with new vigor because of this wonderful herb Mrita Sanjeevani. Thus, the entire Vanara army got saved and they started fighting again. Now, this was unbearable to Indraji and he decided to resort to cunning means to demoralize the army camp. So, what he did was, he got an image of Sita and he carried that image of Sita in the Pushpaka Vimana over the battlefield and acted as if he was slaying that image of Sita in front of the eyes of Rama and Lakshmana. Now looking at this, they felt that the very purpose of this war is totally defeated. They are fighting for Sita and here is Sita being slain in front of their eyes. Rama went into a swoon looking at this. Vibhishana fortunately was present near him. He woke him up and said, please do not believe this. See who is doing all this. It's Indrajit. And he is one who is known for his mayavi tricks. Or sticks of black magic. This is simple deceiving strategy by Indrajit. What you're seeing in front of your eyes is definitely not Sita. I am cocksure it's just an image of Sita. And you need not worry about Sita's safety, because I am sure she is safe and waiting to be redeemed by you from the hands of the cruel Ravana. Listening to these reassuring words of Vibhishana, Rama took heart and came back to normalcy and decided that now Indrajit is getting too much out of hand and something needs to be done to keep him under control. So they were wondering what to do. And at that time, they got to know that Indrajit is going to empower himself more by performing the Nikumbila Yaga. And once he performs this Nikumbila Yaga, he would become unconquerable. He would be invincible. When Vibhishana came to know of this, he went and told Rama that Indrajit should not be allowed to complete this yaga. Otherwise, it would be very difficult for them to win over Ravana's army. So now what would they do? All of them started thinking. Now in Ravana's side, Indrajit and Ravana were the only powerful people left. All other kinsmen of Ravana had been conquered by now. So Indrajit was their sole hope, and how the Vanara army, Rama and Lakshmana would deal with Indrajit was the concern of Rama currently. How they actually dealt with it, we shall see in the next part. Kujantam Rama Rameti Maduram Madhuraksharam Aruhya Kavita Shakham Vande Valmiki Kokilam Yatra Yatra Raghunatha Kirtanam Tatra tatra krita mastakanjalim Bashpavari paripurna lochanam Marutim namatarakshasantakam.
Vaidehi sahitam suradrumatale Haime mahamantape Madhye pushpakamasane manimaye Veerasane susthitam Agrevachayati prabhanjanasute Tattvam munibhyah param vyakhyantam Bharatadibhihi parivritam Ramam bhajeshyamalam. The Ramayana series, part 42, Fall of the Fateful Foe. That's the topic of this part. The great war between the Vanaras and the Rakshasas was going on in full swing. Sri Rama's blessings and the sincere dedication of the Vanaras gave them an upper hand in the war, and they were emerging towards victory. Most of the main Rakshasas, the powerful Rakshasas, were slain, and just about two of them were remaining. One was Indrajit, the eldest son of Ravana, and the other was Ravana himself. Barring these two, all the major warriors of the Rakshasa clan were all slain by the monkeys. And all the monkey warriors who had given up their lives till then in the war were saved by the Mritasanjeevani. In this situation, Indrajit got enraged and decided to perform a special sacrifice known as the Nikumbila Yaga. And by performing the Nikumbila Yaga, Indrajit would become invincible. This was known to Vibhishana. So when Vibhishana got the news about Indrajit performing the Nikumbila Yaga, he warned Rama and told him that if Indrajit would complete this Yaga, then victory for the monkey side would become really, really difficult. So Rama decided to send a group of monkeys to the cave where Indrajit was performing this Nikumbila Yaga and try to stop him from doing so. So with a small troop of monkeys, Lakshmana and Rama proceed towards the cave of Nikumbila. As Lakshmana saw Indrajit perform this Yaga, he told Rama that he wanted his permission to get into war with this Indrajit. He wanted to do his part of service in this great war, to which Rama agreed and sent him with his blessings. It is said that when Lakshmana called out to Indrajit to have a fight with him, Indrajit got very angry. And in his anger, he left the Yaga and he came out. There ensued a great war between the two of them, and Indrajit used as many magic tricks as he knew to fight with Lakshmana. But Lakshmana was more than a match for him. He could easily combat any magic trick that was tried by Indrajit just with his valor and might. And after a long, long fight, which was witnessed by Rama very proudly, Lakshmana finally decided to put a full stop to the fight by slaying Indrajit. It is said that Lakshmana picked up one arrow and processed it with a particular mantra and sent it towards Indrajit so that he could be silenced forever. What was this mantra? This mantra was Dharmatma Satyasandhascha Ramo Dasharathir Yadi Paurushecha Pratidvanve Sharainam Jahiravanim. The mantra was, if the son of Dasharatha Rama is a Dharmatma, is a Satyasandha, is one who is apratidvandi, the one who cannot be conquered by any. If all these things are true, then let this arrow of mine go and slay Indrajit. Now, can there be any more powerful mantra than this? Rama was known to be a Dharmatma. He was the greatest Satyasandha, the truthful one. And certainly he did not have anyone who could stand up against him and be victorious. So he was apratidvandvi, the one without an equal match. So Lakshmana said, if all these words are true, then let my arrow kill Indrajit. How would the arrow miss its target? That was it. That was the end of Indrajit. This mantra of Lakshmana worked, and Indrajit, the eldest son of Ravana, was slain.
the biggest and only support of Ravana at this time, got slain at the hands of the younger brother of Rama. Rama went and embraced Lakshmana so fondly after this victory, and he told him, "Without you, I would have never been able to win this war, my dear little brother. What can I do for you in return? I have no words." So saying, he again embraced him with great love and affection. The news of the fall of Indrajit reached the ears of Ravana, and it was too much for him to handle. In a fit of anger, he sent a special squad of Rakshasas known as the Moolabala. Ravana had kept the squad in reservation for the toughest of battles. It is said that the Moolabala of Ravana consisted of 29 lakh charioteer Rakshasas, 85 lakh elephants, Rakshasas on elephants, 45 lakhs of horses having Rakshasas on their backs, and 100 crores of Rakshasas on foot. This was the size of the Moolabala army. This Moolabala came as a cloud of dust and stood in front of Rama. Rama said, "Don't worry, I shall take care of this." And it is said that Rama immediately gave an effect such that each Rakshasa in this Moolabala was fighting with another Rama. Every other Rakshasa seemed like Rama to the other Rakshasa. Tetu Rama Sahasrani Rane Pashyanti Rakshasaha. Everywhere Rama was seen around the battlefield. Such was his effect and valor that the entire Moolabala felt that each one of them was fighting with Rama. Each one of these numbers that I just quoted felt that he was fighting with a single Rama. Such was the effect of arrows thrown by Rama at each of these Rakshasas in the Moolabala. And within 1/8 of a day, Rama finished the entire Moolabala. Divasasya ashtabhagena sharairagni shikhopamaihi hatanyekena ramena rakshasam kamarupinam. All of these Rakshasas were killed by that one Rama within 1/8 of a day. Such was his valor. No wonder Lakshmana called him Apratidvandvi, the one having no parallel, the one against which no foe can stand. And because of those words of his becoming truthful, he was able to conquer Indrajit. Swami Deshikan couples these two incidents, that is the incident of Indrajit being killed and the Moolabala being destroyed, and puts them into one Churnika and says that these two brothers were a witness of each other when these two events happened. The defeat of Indrajit was a great victory for Lakshmana, and that was witnessed by Rama. And the feat of defeating the Moolabala was uncomparably heroic, and this was witnessed by Lakshmana. So Swami Deshikan says, Abhicharana hutavaha paricharana vighatana sarabasa paripatat aparimita kapibala jaladi lahari kalakalarava kupita maghava jit abhiharana krita anuja sakshika rakshasa dvandva yuddha. Very beautifully Swami Deshikan has coupled these two incidents in this Churnika of his. Once the Moolabala was destroyed, Ravana was left all alone, and he had no other option but to come back to the battlefield. And it is said that this time when he came back to the battlefield, again he was almost left unconscious by Rama. But to save him from being slain by Rama, the charioteer of Ravana drove him away to safety. Saratirata Ratasatra Pashatrava Satyapita Pratapa, says Swami Deshikan. When this happened, and when Ravana regained consciousness, he felt really bad. And he said, "Now I realize the greatness of this enemy of mine, Rama. I feel maybe he is Narayana himself." Tammanye Raghavam Veeram Narayanamanamayam. I feel this Raghava, Rama, is Narayana himself. But he was very upset with this charioteer for having led him away from the battlefield. He said, "You have made me look small in front of my foe. Why did you do this? Take me back to the battlefield." And this time the charioteer took him back to the battlefield. And for the third time, Rama met Ravana. This time, the battle was the final one. Rama and Ravana started fighting against each other. And this fight went on day and night without stopping even for a second, it is said. Naivaratram nadivasam namuhurtam nachakshanam Rama Ravanayor yuddham viramam upagacchati. It was just an unstoppable battle. It was unique. There was no other battle like this. Rama Ravana yuddha. Rama Ravanayor yuddham Rama Ravanayor iva, it is said. The battle between Rama and Ravana was like the battle between Rama and Ravana, because there is no parallel that can be cited for this. It was so unique and so valiant and so full of vigor and energy. So this was just going on, and finally Rama decided to behead Ravana. So he started cutting the heads of Ravana one by one. And Ravana is known to be Dashagriva, or the ten-headed one. And these 10 heads he had offered in a sacrifice to Rudra or Shiva. And Shiva, at the end of that sacrifice, had granted him a boon that if anybody would cut off his heads, they would reappear again. So that's exactly what was happening now. As and when Rama went on cutting the heads of Ravana, they started reappearing again and again. So this was happening for quite some time. As this was happening, the Devas were watching this episode from the heavens. And it is said that when Indra was watching the heads of Ravana appear again, it was like all the 1,000 eyes that he had. Indra has 1,000 eyes, is the belief that's there in scriptures. So all his 1,000 eyes were closing to see the head arise. And when the head would be cut off, all the 1,000 eyes would be wide open in happiness. So like this, Indra's eyes were closing and opening as the heads of Ravana were being beheaded and reappeared. Now this is going on for quite some time. Then Rama was in a fix what to do. At that time, it is said that Rama's charioteer helped him. Now here comes the question. Where was Rama's charioteer from now? Was Rama on a chariot when he did this final war? The answer is yes. It seems Indra sent his chariot along with his charioteer Mathali to help Rama fight Ravana in the final battle. Because finally Rama was doing it for the sake of Devas. So the king of Devas, Indra, thought that he must give him some assistance. And so he had sent his chariot. And the charioteer of Indra, Mathali, reminded Rama that beheading Ravana was not of any use because the heads would reappear because he had the boon of Shiva. So when he was reminded by Mathali of this aspect, Rama remembered one more thing. Sage Agastya had given him a special missile when he was in the Dandakaranya forest. And now time had come for him to use that arrow. So Rama very devoutly uttered the Aditya Hridayam, which is a stotra on sun god. And after uttering the Aditya Hridayam, he took the special arrow given by Agastya and he sent it towards Ravana. And that was the final blow of the fateful foe. With this powerful arrow of Agastya released by the Lord of Lords, the final battle between Rama and Ravana came to an end, and this was the fall of the fateful foe. What pursued later, we shall see in the next part.